It started off as a dare, but it went too far. I was trapped in a trunk, and there was no way of escaping. They piled more and more luggage on top of the trunk. I beat on the trunk, trying to force it open. I even screamed and shouted, but it was so loud that no one heard me. By the time things quieted down, it was too late. The jet's engines began to rumble. My heart sank. We were getting ready for takeoff. I suddenly regretted this whole idea. Why did I want to meet a millionaire in the first place? Let me explain. My best friend's brother works at the airport. He lets us help out in the special hangars from time to time. We carry luggage and pack the small aircrafts for a bit of money. Today, he told us we were packing a private jet that belonged to a millionaire. I've always dreamed about meeting a millionaire. My friends and I joked around with the idea of hiding in the luggage compartment. Then he dared me to do it. I don't like backing down from a challenge, so I climbed into one of the millionaire's unlocked trunks and hid in there. It was only meant to be for a minute, and then my best friend was called away. Now there was nowhere to go. I felt the aircraft take off, and then I imagined what the police of another country would do when they found me. With nothing else to do and nowhere to go, I calmed down, measured my breathing, and started counting in 1, 2, 3, out 1, 2, 3. It worked. At some point, my adrenaline-drained body got tired. I passed out. I woke up in the dark, cramped trunk. My body was aching. My phone was in my pocket. I reached for it and found that it didn't have any signal. We traveled like this for what seemed like days. But when I checked my phone, 5 hours had passed. That was when I felt the jet touch down. I heard the luggage doors open. Then people were talking in a strange language. Soon they rolled the trunk I was in down a ramp. I was loaded into a car, I think. My heart was racing. I knew that any moment, they would open the trunk and find me here. But no one opened the trunk. I remember hearing an elevator and someone grunting when they tried to pick up the trunk. Some guy sat on my trunk and farted. It was terrible as the smell seeped in. I had to stifle a grunt of displeasure and hold my nerve. A few minutes later, I heard the sound of people stopped. I heard a door click shut. I waited a few minutes to make sure, then I pushed open the trunk to peek out. This time, it opened. I was in a hotel room, a very nice one. This was a penthouse suite filled with beautiful furniture, Persian rugs, and the most breathtaking view of the city. And lucky for me, the suite was empty. I walked around and looked out the windows and figured out by the language I was seeing that I was somewhere in France. I found the hotel's Wi-Fi password and logged in. I remembered that my parents would be looking for me soon. So I sent my parents a message. I told them I was going on vacation with my best friend's family. They didn't mind. It was summer vacation and they'd encouraged me to get away for a bit. I called my best friend. He couldn't believe my story. He begged me to tell the millionaire what had happened. I couldn't though. If I did, my best friend's brother would lose his job. No, I was going to need another plan and I needed it fast. As a kid, I was always great at playing hide and seek. I knew how to be quiet and steer clear of people. So far, my hiding skills had worked. With a bit of planning, I thought I could keep hiding and have a nice little holiday in the process. I decided to try this out. What did I have to lose? Now that I was in the suite, there was no need to get back into the trunk. I found all the hiding places in each room and was always ready just in case the door opened. I ordered myself room service and charged it to the room. I ate quickly and hid the evidence. I hoped that no one would notice the extra billings. I went through the millionaire's luggage, trying to find out who she was. It was definitely a woman. She had a good fashion sense, but a weird obsession with sweets. Half of her luggage was filled with gummy bears, licorice, and other exotic candy. I wasn't proud of what I did next. I took some money that she'd left in the hotel room. Not to spend it, but to have as a backup plan to get home. If this blew up in my face, I was going to need some cash to get me back home quickly. At 9 p.m. that night, the door opened and the millionaire came back. I couldn't believe my eyes. She was a fashion designer. I remember seeing her in different magazines. Fashion wasn't my thing, but this lady stood out. She was eccentric and colorful. She was also known for being impatient and even had a temper when it came to answering silly questions. In the photos, she always wore the most extravagant, even ridiculous outfits. Tonight, she was so exhausted that she literally flopped onto her bed and started snoring. When I was sure she wasn't going to get up, I fell asleep in the far corner of the next room. The knock on the door the next morning woke me up. I heard the millionaire fashion designer speaking to someone from the hotel. She was telling them that she didn't know what they were talking about. She didn't order any room service. She sounded irritated. My heart started beating faster. The door closed, and she started getting ready for the day. I relaxed. It was a close one. I was going to have to be more careful from now on. I spent the morning watching TV and reading the documents that she'd left behind from her meetings the day before. I also found her diary and looked at her schedule. I saw that this would be her final day in the city. For the next month, she would be visiting 15 countries around the world. Part of me was excited by the idea of all this travel, but another part of me cringed. It meant a lot of time hiding out in the trunk. The silver lining was that, with her busy schedule, I may get a chance to see cities I never dreamed of visiting. Now I just needed a way of affording this little holiday. It didn't take me long to think of an idea. My best friend back home is a computer geek who's obsessed with auctioning stuff online. I was sure this fashion designer had raving fans from around the world who would pay good money for her belongings. I went online and found recent photos of her. I matched what I saw in the photos to what I found in her wardrobe: rainbow-colored stilettos, a blouse that reminded me of a blue marshmallow, and a scarf that looked like an electrified boa constrictor. I contacted my best friend. Within an hour, he had created an online auction for these items. I hoped it would work. And within 2 hours, I couldn't believe what was happening. People from around the world were making huge bids for these items. I didn't feel great about stealing from her, but I knew that right now I didn't have many choices. We sold the stilettos to someone in India an hour later. My friend wired me some of the money. I snuck out of the hotel, making sure that I had a spare room card with me. I found a company that packaged the shoes and shipped them off to the lucky bid winner. While I was out, I bought myself new clothes and saw different parts of the city. I knew my host would be out until 7 p.m. that night, so I arrived back at the hotel with plenty of time to spare. Over the next few days, the millionaire followed her schedule like clockwork. She may have been eccentric in the way she dressed, but she was seriously organized. We traveled to a new city. The trip was much shorter, and my time in the trunk was easier. I wasn't so stressed out this time. I opened the trunk in a new hotel suite. It was just as luxurious. Lucky for me, just as empty. Days passed like this. I snuck out, saw a bit of the city, and got back before the millionaire arrived home. We traveled through 5 famous cities in this way. I was getting used to this routine. Well, I was, until the millionaire decided to do something that wasn't in her diary. On a Saturday afternoon, I listened from the closet as she changed her plans. She was going to have a party in her suite, and it was going to start in 30 minutes. I had nowhere to go. I was stuck in this closet. I listened as people flooded into the suite, bringing food, music, and entertainment. The party began. I listened from the closet. It sounded like people were having a good time. I would have fallen asleep like this if I didn't hear the closet door opening. I held my breath. It was the millionaire. She was trying to hang up her coat, but she kept missing the hook inside the door. She giggled as she did this. She was behaving very differently to the way she normally did in her room. She was much more relaxed. I tried to make myself as small as possible, but the coat kept falling. It landed on me. She reached for it and squealed when she touched my hair. I tried not to move, but I couldn't help it. She pulled the coat off me, seeing me hiding in the corner of this tiny closet. I knew that it was over now. My mind raced with what would happen next. Would she send me to jail once she found out I had stolen her items? I was about to apologize to her, to tell her that I was sorry for hiding out and selling her things, when she interrupted me. "My dear, what are you doing in the closet?" she said to me. "Don't be shy. Guests need to mingle." She helped me out of the closet and welcomed me to the party. She told me that there were better places to hide if I didn't want to speak to people, like the balcony because of its view of the city. I noticed the glass of wine in her hand and I felt relieved. The alcohol was making her a lot friendlier, even to someone she'd found in the closet. There must have been 100 people there. I don't think she knew more than 5 of the guests, and she thought that I was one of them. I spent most of the night talking to the millionaire fashion designer. It turns out she was a pretty cool person. We actually had a few things in common. In fact, we were both from the same small town, the home that she grew up in. She told me how boring most of these parties were, but she was really enjoying this one for a change. We spoke about what she planned next in her business and how she'd become so successful. We danced, laughed, and had an amazing time. I met some very interesting people at this party. I also ate a lot of candy, and eventually I fell asleep on the couch. It felt great not having to hide for the first time in almost a month. I woke up the next morning on the couch. There was a cleaning crew tidying up the mess from the night before. Most of the guests had left. Some were still sleeping on the couches in the suite. The millionaire was dressed and getting ready to leave. She saw me and thanked me for the company last night. She told me that the next time she was home, she'd stop by and visit me. She called the reception, and a few minutes later, 5 men were carrying her luggage out of the room. They took everything, including my traveling trunk. I tried to keep cool and smile, but seeing them carrying out my travel trunk made me panic. I shouted for them to stop. The millionaire looked at me strangely. I smiled at her and told her that it looked like something that belonged to me. Then she stopped and turned back to me. She asked me if I had seen anyone wearing a pair of rainbow stilettos. By the way she looked at me, I was sure she knew that I'd taken them. I took a deep breath and shook my head. She paused for a moment and then shrugged. She said it was one of the reasons she didn't like these parties. So many strangers would take little souvenirs home with them. They were her favorite pair of heels. She shook her head and gave me a goodbye wave. I waved back and watched her leave. Standing there in the middle of this empty hotel room, a knot was forming in my stomach. The knot was still there as I walked out of the hotel. I didn't need to sneak around anymore. I felt great about that. But at the same time, my holiday was officially over. The good news was that I wasn't far from home. I was at least on the same continent. I took 4 trains and 3 buses to get back. It took me another week of traveling. Eventually, I arrived. Standing outside my house, I realized how much I actually enjoyed all the traveling. My best friend was relieved to see me. He told me how much money we'd made from auctioning the millionaire's stuff. I couldn't believe it. We were almost millionaires now too. And I had an idea then. One that my best friend liked. About a month later, my doorbell rang. It was the fashion designer. I couldn't believe it. She told me that she remembered me telling her where I lived. She invited me out to lunch. I'll be honest, it was kind of strange to be speaking to her again. Strange because I felt kind of guilty for everything I had done. But at the same time, it was fun. We really got along quite well. She told me about her recent trips and the new clothing line that she was launching. She brought up the rainbow stilettos again, telling me how hard it was to find a good pair of shoes. I tried not to look guilty, but I think it showed. The fashion designer told me about how traveling was becoming more and more of a pain because of all the luggage that she carried around with her. So many people were always giving her things that she didn't want, but she didn't want to hurt their feelings by refusing the gifts. And then I had the idea, a way that we could work together. My business idea was simple. I would take some of the items that she didn't need anymore and auction them online. She listened carefully and nodded. She liked the idea. All she asked was that some of the money be donated to her favorite charity. I agreed. Together with my best friend's help, we began auctioning off her unwanted items. Over the next few months, she sent me all sorts of clothing, shoes, and jewelry, along with photos of her wearing these items. My best friend loaded them up onto the online auction site. The lucky winners received a box, along with a real letter from the fashion designer, thanking them for their purchase. What started off as stealing turned into a legal business for my best friend and I. Within a year, we were millionaires. And best of all was that we now had a millionaire business partner. There was something that bothered me though. The rainbow stilettos, I still felt guilty about them. So I tracked down the original buyer. By now, we had the money to buy back the rainbow stilettos from her for twice what she paid for them. She agreed to sell them. You should have seen the fashion designer's face when I gave her a box with the rainbow stilettos. She was so happy. She asked me how I found them. I told her it didn't matter. She paused, closed the box, and pushed it back to me. Keep the shoes. Just remember to send a fraction of the money that you gain from the auction of these to the charity. My gaze dropped, and I shook my head furiously as she sipped her coffee. Did she even know what I had gone through to get these silly shoes back? We sat in silence, wondering how much she knew. Then I relaxed. It didn't matter now. As I looked back at the past few months, I realized how crazy this all was. From being locked in a trunk to being business partners with a millionaire fashion designer. Sometimes life takes you on a wild ride. All you have to do is hold on tight and see where it goes.